Man that we're going to be reviewing today, and that is Stephen. Stephen is listed as being one of the first deacons in Scripture. So when we look at this his life, we got to see what things we can draw from him that would benefit us in our walks. What characteristics that we see in his life are things that we can also emulate to help us walk with the Lord. You know, the single greatest thing we can do as Christians is to serve Jesus in whatever way that he wants to use us. You know, sometimes, you know, as Christians, especially young Christians, we come into this with this idea, oh, I want to do this and I want to do that. But the question is, what does God want you to do at this moment? Because it can change. At one moment, he may want you to do one thing. The next moment, he wants you to do something else. But the question is, what is it that he wants us to do? So this morning, we're going to look at a man that did just that. As the early church grew, there were needs that were presented to them, and Stephen was ready and he was available. Stephen's life is a continual challenge to the Christians because he was the first to die for his faith. His sacrifice raises questions on how many risks do we take in being Jesus' followers. How many risks do we really take in being a follower of Jesus? Would we be willing, as he did, to die for him? I've had that thought cross my mind periodically for different reasons. You know, we look at our society, we look at the direction that the world's going in, and you consider the fact that we're probably not that far away before people start saying, you know, that word of God is nothing but hate speech. Because when you consider the content of the Word of God, it's very contrary to this world system and the things that are being pushed in this world system. So I've had that thought in my mind, that would I continue to preach this Word to represent God as a Christian, even if it was considered to be a crime to do so? I pray that we don't have to respond to that. But I would not be surprised if sometime, someday, that becomes the issue before the Lord returns. The other question would be along with that is, are we willing to live for him? Are we willing to live for him? And what that speaks of is our life, what makes up our life, where we go on a daily basis, the contacts that we have on a daily basis. Are we willing to allow him to live through us within those contacts, within those conversations, within the little humor that takes place in the cafeteria or in our family gatherings? Are we willing to live for him? So as we review what Scripture reveals about his life, let's see what we can apply to our own walks. What we will see from Stephen's life is this. First, striving for excellence in small assignments prepares one for greater responsibilities. There's really no such thing as a small job in God's kingdom, no small task. And that's why we should strive for excellence. This is something that Stephen was able to do. And this is one of the things that separated him from others, was his desire to do the best that he could with the opportunities that he was given. Also, a real understanding of God always leads to a practical and compassionate actions towards people. As we live our lives before the Lord and loving him, the natural outcome of that will be loving his people. The more that we become like him, the more that Christ is absorbed within who we are, the more naturally it becomes for us to actually share that love with other people, because we're becoming like him. If he loves us that much, that even while we were yet sinners, he sent his son, How much more do you think that he would expect those that follow him to have that same kind of love and compassion for this world, for each other, especially those of the body of Christ? How much love do you think that he would expect us to have? He would expect us to have his love, right? So, God does love his creation. And even though there's some people that, you know, we know this for sure. There's some people that sort of like get you. You know, there's some people know how to really tweak you. You know, you ever have that in your life, you know? That there's certain people that come along and you're like, oh, not them. Oh, Lord, help me. I mean, really, it's like it's a drain on the kingdom of heaven right now because I need extra power to deal with that one because he seems to get me going. You know, and you try your best, like, I'm not going to let him get me this time. I'm not going to let him. And sometimes you have a victory and sometimes you don't. Well, we have to keep focusing on the Lord to allow his life to be revealed to that person. Because at some point, they're going to get it. Or it could be that they're just that thorn in the flesh that God ordained for you to grow. Wouldn't you say, oh, great, hallelujah, thank you, Jesus, for that one. I really need that person to keep me growing and keep me humble, right? Well, it could be the case. So this morning we'll see how Stephen modeled these key ingredients to serving the Lord and why he is considered to be, you know, one of the more exceptional people in scriptures. And personally, I believe Acts chapter 7 is probably one of the greatest messages that is listed within scripture, as well as a complete listing of what took place with God's people, Israel. So some background on where we are in Acts. Okay, we'll just give you some highlights of some of the previous chapters. In Acts chapter 1, we have the Lord ascending into heaven. Acts chapter 2, we have the Holy Spirit appearing in the upper room. And we know that the things that came along with that, as the Holy Spirit came in, they began to speak with other tongues. And as they went out into the community, people that didn't even speak a language could now speak that language. Those who didn't speak Greek now could speak Greek, and they could hear in the gospel in their own ears. It was just a wonderful thing. Acts chapter 2 also has a time frame where Peter gave his message at the end of that time. It was listed as 3,000 people coming to Christ as a result of it. Acts chapter 3, we have Peter and John healing a lame man. In Acts chapter 4, we see the result of that. Obviously, anytime you want to heal someone, they're going to bring you before the council, which is just a weird thing. Can you imagine that nowadays? You know, you walk along, somebody's lame, they can't walk, you pray for them, they heal, and they get up, and the police come along and arrest you. How dare you? What's wrong with you? In whose name do you do this? That makes a lot of sense. Anyway, that's just people for you, because we're really a unique breed. So Peter's brought before the council along with John, and he speaks boldly before the council, and he tells them by whose name he made this miracle take place. It was by the name of Jesus Christ, whom you crucified. Oh, they loved that one. In Acts chapter 5, Ananias and Sapphira decided to do something that I would not recommend, and that's called lying to the Holy Spirit when they misrepresented the amount of money that was being given. At that time, because of the challenges within the community, and we'll get into some of this as we get into our message, they were forced to actually have things in common. You know, I think sometimes we think of what took place in that time frame where it talks about they had everything in common was like, oh, let's start a cult. It'll be just us. That's not what happened. This was something they were forced to do because of society's pressure against them. So Ananias and Sapphira, as a part of the congregation, decided they were going to sell some land and give the money, you know, for this cause, because they were saying, we don't own anything, we're going to give it all to you. But they didn't really actually represent the actual amount that they were giving for the land appropriately. And because they lied about that, they both lost their lives. During this time also, many signs and wonders were being performed by the apostles, and the church continued to grow. I mean, it's a wonderful thing. I can't wait to, you know, we get to heaven. We can actually, I hope there's like a movie room that you can go into and see all these events that took place You know, that would just be such a cool thing to see how this all transpired and how the early church actually grew amongst all the pressure that it was dealing with. But despite all the things that were going on, the word of God continued to go forward and the church grew. Now, often when we read in scriptures and we hear terminology nowadays, we try to reference back and we associate things that we see today to things that took place back then. But just that term that I mentioned right there, church, when we think of church, we think of this. This is a church, right? We come together, we meet in church. When are you going to be at church? Well, if it was me today, it would be at 5 past. Right? So that's our mind of church. But their church gathering was different back then in the early church. They were gathering in homes. It wasn't as, you know, as a public thing as we see it. Because the early church didn't actually hold services in a building until the basilicas came along in 313 AD. That was with Constantine making Christianity legal in Rome, where at that point in time, they were able to actually go into large facilities and actually hold church. Different story. The order of service was not like we have right now. You know, they didn't come in and have some guy do introductions and have the band come up and have the bass player play. I don't know what they did without a bass player, but that's another story. They were still considered to be anti-God by the religious community. And if you consider that Judaism wasn't something that you would look at and go, that's just what they believe. And then down the street you have something else. That was their whole world. It was more than just their faith. It was their society. It was built around this. So if you was contrary to that, you were being ostracized from life as you know it. Jesus was still considered to be a heretic for declaring himself to be God's son. Now, the reason why I read the background is just to let you know that it wasn't that long ago that Christ had just ascended. It wasn't that long ago that they were marveling at how people that were dead and in graves came back to life after his ascension. There was a lot of things that were going on that weren't that long ago. But they've already fast-forwarded to,
he was just a heretic. That didn't really all happen. The temple and the thing here. That was just an accident. That was just bad craftsmanship.
They could actually just put everything off and say it really didn't matter and just get right back into how things were before. And this is what the early church was dealing with. But Stephen was deeply involved by this time within the church, and he had gained a reputation for being a man dedicated to the Lord. So when it came time to select the first deacons, it was obvious that he would be included in that number. The point here is that our reputation does matter. Our reputation, it matters. You know, what our family thinks of us, what our coworkers think of us, what our neighbors think of us, all these things matter. Because, you know, you can very easily say, God knows my heart. Yes, he does. And it's wicked. We all have that within us. None of us are perfect, right? None of us are. We all have faults. We all have opportunities to fail, to let each other down. That's life. But it does matter how we live. That's our reputation. You know, Switchfoot has a song. My daughter probably could sing it for me right now, but the title, and I was thinking of it as I was writing this part, and it said, life is short, you gotta live it well. Right? It's short. We don't know where our time frame is. God knows. God knows exactly when our time is. But the idea for us is to realize that life is short. And we gotta take the opportunity for the time that we have to live it well so that we've had the opportunity to allow Christ to live through us. And it's not from the sense of people looking at us and go, wasn't he just a wonderful guy? We just love him. It's, he was someone that loved Christ and you could see light in him because of Christ. The point is, are we leading people to Christ with our reputation? Or are we chasing them from him? I know some people that profess to be Christians, and I know they are Christians, But they have just this challenge of chasing people away with how they do things. And it's a sad thing. We have to get past that. And I know there's things probably in my life that just irk you as well. But we have to do our best not to allow those things to chase people away from God. So let's look at our study today. We'll begin with Acts chapter 6, not 7, in verse 1. Now at this time, while the disciples were increasing in number, a complaint arose on the part of the Hellenistic Jews against the native Hebrews because their widows were being overlooked in the daily serving of food. Okay? So first we have to do is look at who are the people within this verse that are being referenced. So the Hebrews were the Jews that were more inclined to embrace the Jewish culture. So when speaking of the Hebrews, it's speaking of those who actually were from Judea, they lived in that area, okay, and that was their background. But they're Jewish. Same with the Hellenists. They were Jewish, but they were those that actually were taken from that area and grew up in a different culture. So they grew up in the Greek culture. That's why they called them the Hellenistic Jews. They were more a part of the dispersion that we'll reference a little bit later on as well. So you have the different sense of what's going on. And the reason why I mention this, it was not just in the church that this was reality, but in the society at that time. The culture at that time was made up of those who were homegrown Jews. And then you had those who actually had come back after the dispersion. And there was this little thing between the two of them because the Hellenistic Jews spoke Greek, okay? And then you had the Jews that were
the homegrown Jews
that did. So there's always that little culture conflict that was going on there. So now you see that they were complaining, thinking that, well, just because we're the Hellenistic Jews, our widows are not being treated the same way. And it was looking at this as being almost like a racial thing, okay? So for the most part, the Hebrews tended to regard the Hellenists as unspiritual and compromises with the Greeks because of the fact that they had to spend that much time away. The Hellenists regard the Hebrews as the holier-than-thou traditionalists. There was already a natural suspicion between the two groups, and of course, Satan tried to use this to his advantage and taking use of the standing suspicion to turn it into something else. So we have a society that already has that built into it. Out of that society, you have a group that are following Christ. And they still have that same attitude. And that thing was being used to work against them. So worth noting is now that these women were now Christians. They had been cut off from the support that the temple would provide. So the temple would normally take care of those that were widows. And they could go into the Jewish temple and they would receive some form of support. But for those who were Christians, that was not so. Because now they're being ostracized from their own religion, also from the support system that they would have as well. In many cases, from their families. So we look at, you know, our society today, things are completely different. Well, you need support. Out of a job, need some help, you can go to the government. Well, the government wasn't helping them. That's not what was the structure back then. Then it was the people of God that was helping themselves, okay? So that's a different thing to consider. But now we have a serious disturbance in the church. The early church was going through its first challenge. And it began because of an unintentional oversight. So here is the church growing. The gospel's just being spread out by Peter and John and the disciples, and they're being filled with the Spirit. They're just on fire. All of a sudden, you had complaints coming in. No, I don't think this is right. Yeah, just because I'm a Hellenist, that they're not allowing me to get food. What's that all about? It's because they're all Hebrews. They're because they're locals. And this little division starts. You know, and it doesn't take much for a division to turn into something big. So it really was important for them to handle this appropriately. But I can say this first, though. Let's do each other a favor. If we, as individuals, have the same potential within us, let's try to give each other a little bit of grace. Because we're going to have those moments when we're going to unintentionally do something that may hurt you. So on my behalf, on behalf of the leadership of the church as well, we want to apologize if we've done anything that has offended anyone. It's not intentional. But those things do happen. But you know what can happen from those things? Divisions. People start doing this. Talking amongst themselves. And it builds into this big thing of energy. So you look at it and say, well, how did this thing get in the scripture? Because of this. Okay? And as we start looking at things and start personalizing, they're doing this to me because I am this. You know, we start taking it further than it really needs to be. So let's look to see what exactly happened in this thing. Because, you know, we all make mistakes. And at that time, that was an oversight. They weren't intentionally not giving them funds. It was just something that had just happened. Okay. So what is the best response to a dispute? I'll tell you, because you're sitting there and you don't think that you have anything to say. You're thinking this, but you can't say it because you're like, that would be rude to yell that out. The best response to a dispute is wisdom. And it's God's wisdom. Anytime there's some sort of conflict, that's the best response we have is wisdom. You know, if there's a need, you know, we have to fill that need, right? And there was a need for wisdom at this point in time. So we look on in Acts chapter 2 through verse 6. We'll read through this. It says, so the 12 summoned the congregation of the disciples and said, it is not desirable for us to neglect the word of God in order to serve tables. Therefore, brethren, select from among you 7 men of good reputation, full of the Spirit and wisdom, whom we may put in charge of this task. But we will devote ourselves to prayer and to the ministry of the word. Now the statement found approval with the whole congregation. And they chose Stephen, a man full of faith and of the Holy Spirit, and Philip, and Prochorus, and Nicanor, Timon. Nobody's in here named Fred. You notice that? Parmenas and Nicholas, a proselyte from Antioch. Now, one thing that's really unique about this, if you look at these names, and it may not just jump into your head because they're very unfamiliar name types, but all of these names are actually Greek names. Aha. The first sign of wisdom. Greek names. Remember the problem, right? The Hellenists were Greek speaking, were the ones that were complaining. The congregation selects out of the group Greek men. Interesting. And these they brought before the apostles, and after praying, they laid hands on them. So first, here's a question for you. They were being tasked with, these 7 men, which were being identified as being the first deacons, even though the title itself was not given to them, they're recognized as being the first deacons. They clearly fulfill the responsibilities listed by Paul and Timothy about what a deacon should uphold. And at this time, I'd like to thank our deacons here as well for their service and their commitment, because nothing happens around here without the deacons. Now, why did they lay hands on them? Because it didn't seem like this was such a great task. It's not like they said, okay, we're going to send you off to Asia to go preach the gospel. Let's lay hands on you for God's protection. You know, when people are going away, we lay hands on them and so that God could be with them. You would think, this is not really that major of a task. Why are they laying hands on them? Well, if what they're doing was a practical thing, you would think that it's really not that important. But let me tell you something. Practical things are very important. The small things are very important. Just like we mentioned earlier, right? The small responsibilities, being faithful in the small things, is which allows us to actually be used in a greater capacity. You know, some would look at what Christ did in John chapter 13 in washing his disciples' feet as being a small thing. But that was a great message. And sometimes it's those little things that can have the most powerful impact on someone's life. So if we look at verse 2, where it mentions that they would say what they were going to focus on. He said, well, it's important for us to focus on the Word of God. The intention here was not to say that this was a task that was below them, but rather to point out that it was to everyone's best interest that they oversee, that these men oversee the delivery of the meals so that the apostles themselves could focus on prayer and the Word of God. And that's really a critical thing to consider, because that just speaks of how, even within our church, how delegation should work. And the reason why we need delegation in a church is because you can't have Pastor Dave doing everything. That's why he's away right now, people. You burnt him out. No, I'm only kidding. No, what I'm saying is that we all have a part. That's why God has gifted us all with the very specific gifts, because not two or three people don't run this place. There's a lot of people that make this whole thing go forward. And each one of us is very valuable and very critical to the success of God's word being impactful from this local assembly. So I want to thank each and every single one of you. Even if you say, well, I don't do much. I pass out a bulletin. Let me tell you something. I can't do that because I'm supposed to be doing something else, right? We all have a role in this thing, you know? So this is here for us. Okay. Yeah, give yourself a hand. There you go. So what the apostles tell the congregation is, look, find for yourself men that are what? Of good reputation. Once again, we mentioned reputation. That are full of the Spirit, and those that are full of wisdom as well. A good reputation should be synonymous with the term Christian if we walk in the Spirit and are led by God's wisdom. That should be one and the same. So it's not something that we have to strive to do. Oh, I want to strive to have a great reputation. No, what you want to do is strive to be close to God. That's the only thing you need to do. Draw close to Him. I love that song that Deb sang this morning, by the way. And thank you for sharing that. And that's where we need to be. The closer that we get to Him, the more like Him we will become. That will have an impact on who we live as, therefore our reputation. I want to share something with you, just to give you a little brain break, because I know it's something you keep so focused. I can focus on the Word of God. I can't take it. I don't want to miss anything. So I'm going to give you a commercial. Okay? You don't have to focus so much on this one. I'm literally giving you a chance to just say, I don't have to pay attention to this at all. And I'll let you know when to come back in. But for those who want to get the point, pay attention. Okay? Now it's all in your hands. But here's a quick illustration for you about reputation. There was a company that hired a management consultant to appraise the personnel efficiency reports that were made out by managers and supervisors. So this company hires this consultant to come in, and the supervisors and managers of the company were actually writing up appraisals of each one of their management team under them. And this company that was going to come in, they're thinking, oh, we're going to read through these things, and there's going to be all these glowing reports about, oh, that's so wonderful, blah, 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 blah. But they were kind of surprised about what they found. I'll just give you a couple of them, because I thought they were kind of unique. The first one is a statement from first where it says, this foreman has talents, but has kept them well hidden. Yeah, he has talents, but he keeps them well hidden. Another one says, in any change in policy or procedure, he can be relied upon to produce the most improbable hypothetical situation in which the new policy cannot work. Anybody know anybody like that? All right. Here's another one. A person says they're open to suggestions, but they never follow them. Okay. And lastly, this person, never makes the same mistake twice, but it seems to have made all of them at least once. So the reason why I include that was just to get you to chuckle a little bit, but also to let you see, this is something that was a part of their reputation. You know, we don't do performance evaluations for church. Well, most of you, you know, employers, employees, you know, you're familiar with the terminology and the process, right? You go through a year and somebody sits down, they write about, oh, you did this well, you did that well, or you had this goal, you didn't make it, blah, 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 oh, you're wonderful, whatever it may be, okay? That's something that we were used to within in the workforce. If that was something that God would do and say, okay, let's do an appraisal of your reputation right now. Oh, wouldn't that be unique? Yeah, I wouldn't want to go there. Yeah. So, but your reputation does matter. So the question would be, what are we known for? That's what speaks of your reputation. What are you known for? When people hear your name, what do they think of? Right? I'm not going to say any words up here that would get me into trouble either. Are you known for the one bringing to a situation calmness or more drama? Are you known for laying down your life or running down politicians? What are you known for? The more that we talk, the easier it is to be misunderstood. And that's just a reality of life. In Ecclesiastes 5:2, it says, do not be hasty in word or impulsive in thought to bring up a matter in the presence of God. For God is in heaven and you are on the earth. Therefore, let your words be few. I think sometimes we talk too much. We post too much. Enough said about that. Now, so he said, find men a good reputation. Stephen was known for being full of faith and of the Holy Spirit. In Acts 6:5, it says the statement found approval with the congregation, and they chose Stephen, a man full of grace and faith, full of faith and of the Holy Spirit. Now, these men were qualified because they had already established themselves in the faith and leading of the Holy Spirit. Point: before people can live their lives for the gospel, they must first live their lives. Excuse me, let me read that again. Before people can live their lives for the gospel, they must first live their lives for the gospel. One way God trains us is to place us in the seemingly insignificant positions. You know, that's just a part of the preparation. So, this is where true passion is revealed. And it's not the true passion for the task, it's the true passion for the Lord. The task isn't the issue. It has nothing to do with the issue. The issue is, what is your passion for the Lord? That's going to be revealed in your response to whatever it is that you're doing. You know, there's a thing I wanted to reference you back to my upbringing. And my father had a great impact on me in the early years. I was brought up in the church. And get a chance to see a lot of different things. You know, when you're in church all the time, from the time that you're a literally from the time I was born, you know, you get a chance to see different things. And it taught me a lot. But the one thing for sure is the closer you get to the Lord, the less that you care about what he calls you to do. It's just doing whatever is necessary. And that's one thing I saw my father do plenty of times, just what was necessary. You know, the roof had a leak. He'd go up on the roof and fix it. You know, he's just one of those guys that, you know, something was needed, he just went ahead and did it. And we do these things just because we want to please the Lord, not because it's a chore, it's not a task, it's an expression of love. Stephen's heart was full of faith, and he was led by the Spirit, so this task was something that he gladly took on. You know, one of the things I recall, my father was the fact that he was a singer, as well as my mother was a singer, and they both sang in the gospel choir and in the senior choir and all these other choirs. Spent a lot of time in church listening to them sing. And I can always look at picture my father singing songs, and he was different times he would sing lead, and just his passion in the song, just how he related in the song, he literally would throw his head back and he would just wail sometimes. And you could just see how much love he had for God and what he was struggling with at that time in his life, despite those things. Stephen's had that kind of passion that was evident. And that's what people saw in his life, that he loved the Lord. And that's why he, along with the others, was selected based upon their passion. In Acts chapter 6, we see that these were brought before the apostles, and after praying, they laid hands on them. The word of God kept on spreading, and the number of the disciples continued to increase greatly in Jerusalem, and a great many of the priests were becoming obedient to the faith. So the first church split was avoided because there were men that were prepared to be used by God. They were ready and available to be used by God. Now, in the verses that follow, we can see that Stephen not only took on the task of ensuring that the widows were handled appropriately, he was noted as performing great wonders and signs among the people. So if you look at verse 8, it says, "And Stephen, full of grace and power, was performing great wonders and signs among these people." Sounds familiar. I just mentioned that, didn't I? Okay. Now, what was done isn't mentioned, but the mere fact that this was recorded in Scripture shows you how powerful those things would be. Because you have to consider, well, how did this actually get in the Scripture? All right, was somebody following him around and writing these things? Oh, this is what Stephen's doing. Who wrote Acts? Luke. Okay? How would Luke know what was going on here? Well, who was Luke very close to? Paul. Right? Paul was someone who actually was in the vicinity of this while this was taking place. And we see that as you read through Acts chapter 7. When Stephen was actually stoned, Paul was there. Okay? Matter of fact, the church or the synagogue that Paul was a part of was actually one of the ones that was in that the group classified as the Hellenistic groups. It was one of the Cecilia, I think I'm pronouncing that wrong, but it was that group. So it's considered that he was actually very familiar with what was taking place at this time as well. But for some reason, these things were being listed as being great wonders and signs. Okay. 6:9 it says, "But some men from what was called the synagogue of freedmen, including both the Cyrenians and the Alexandrians and some of the Cilicia," that's the group that Paul was a part of, "in Asia, rose up and argued with Stephen." Interesting. So here's Stephen, newly ordained to take care of this task of making sure the widows had their food and their task. But that's not all that he was. And I think that's a pretty unique thing when you consider his life. He said, yeah, he was asked to do this task that some would look at as being a small task, but he was someone actually that did more than just that. And he's going on not just taking care of that task and making sure this job was taken care of and that the complaint issue was resolved. His life was just bigger than that because God was using him in a mighty way. So the synagogue of freedmen decided that they were going to start challenging him in some of the things that he was saying. Because as he's preaching the gospel, this is going directly against what they believed as Jews. They looked at this as being a personal attack on their very culture. So his opponents, these certain parties of various synagogues that were around the city, some rabbis note that it could have been over 480 different synagogues at that time, but the designation was listed as being a libertine, so some Bibles actually may say libertines versus a synagogue of freemen. But this was the same group. There were freemen who had been slaves. Their fathers had been sold as bondmen to Rome after Pompey's expedition against Judea in B.C. 53. That's how those individuals, the Hellenists, actually ended up being in other regions because of what took place. Pompey came in, captured people. Okay, now they're going to be slaves. Then they were freed, and they went back home. But now they spoke Greek, okay? Because of being in the Greek culture for so long, they actually lost some of their natural language. Now, coming back, that's where that little division came in, and people started looking at each other a little differently. Oh, you're the ones that were away. You're the ones that speak Greek. We're the ones with, there's nothing wrong with us. It's almost like the Sumerians with the Jews, that kind of contention. So here they are, contending with Stephen about the truth. But they were unable to cope with the wisdom and the spirit in which he was speaking. Which does not surprise me. Because you know something? When you're filled with the Spirit and you're walking with God and you have God's wisdom, you don't have to struggle. You don't have to. But it's amazing how other people, when they're coming against you, they're like, oh, yeah, well, what about this? And you say, well, you know, this is what it is. We don't have to strive as servants of God. The victory has already been won. We are completely convinced. You know, they can come in here right now. Somebody from the outside could come in, and they could say, I don't believe this. This is all a crutch. Show me God right now. I don't see a God. He can't be real. Nah, that's your problem. That is not going to make me anxious. I'm sorry. You know, whether or not you believe or not is your issue between you and God. That's not my problem right now. I can tell you what the truth is. If you don't want it, you don't want it. Doesn't mean I'm not going to love you. Oh, yeah. Well, and people get so, I got to be right. Okay. You can believe what you want to believe. You can call me all the names you want to call me. That's not going to change anything. Jesus Christ is still on the throne. He's still God. What do you want me to do about that? You know? But that's human nature for you, and we'll run into that. And that's exactly what Stephen was running into. They were just beside themselves. How dare you say these things? All right, so what were their issue? We'll see what was coming on. Because they were unable to cope with him. So because of this, they said they were secretly induced men to say, we have heard him speak blasphemous words against Moses and against God. Oh, this is going down a familiar path, isn't it? So their dispute was the fact that Stephen was preaching the doctrine related to Jesus Christ. What Christ came to do. The fact that he was the fulfillment of the promised Messiah. And what that means for us now. They didn't like that idea because they didn't realize that he was the Messiah. Also, what Stephen was speaking about was the passing away of the Old Testament temple worship.
Oh, wait a minute now. Let's not touch the temple.
And that's just where they were coming from.
Nope. The temple's holy. God gave us the temple. You cannot touch. No, I am not listening to anything you have to say. And that's pretty much how staunch they were about the whole thing. How dare you say that the temple is not as critical, that God resides right there in the temple?
No, he don't. Only place, I mean, he may reside in there, but you know where else he is? Every place else. Every place else. And they couldn't get the idea around the fact that the old form of temple worship was being abolished. That can't be true. This is our culture. You're destroying the very fabric of our society. What's wrong with you, Stephen? So what did they do? They enticed or induced men to say that he was speaking blasphemous words against Moses and against God. You know, it's amazing how quickly they forget the last time this was done. Right? They did the same thing with Jesus. Exact same thing. They induced people to say, oh, this is heresy. This person is crazy. He's beside himself. He says he's the Son of God. Yeah, look at him on the cross. What's wrong with him? Acts chapter 6, verse 12 says, and they stirred up the people and the elders and the scribes, and they came up to him. And they dragged him away, and they brought him before the council. They put forward false witnesses who said, this man incessantly speaks against the holy place and the law. For we have heard him say that this Nazarene, you know, sort of like this Nazarene, Jesus, will destroy this place and alter the customs which Moses handed down to us. Yeah, he did. Exactly. He did exactly what he said. Okay. You know, it's amazing how the people were enticed to really go against Stephen, you know. Popular opinion can be easily shaped. And the same crowds that praised Jesus were also a part of him when he was being crucified. So those that were saying, oh, Hosanna, Hosea, the same crowd was a part of it when he was saying, crucify him, crucify him. There were people that were in the same, both crowds. The same thing happened with Stephen. There were people that were listening to him and marveling at his miracles and the wonders that he performed were also a part of this crowd now that led him to this point. This is why we should never let popular opinion shape the vision of a church. It's all going to be based on God's word alone. So in Acts chapter 6, verse 15, it says, and fixing their gaze on him, all who were sitting in the council saw his face like the face of an angel. So here they are all, and I just love picturing things like this. Here they are all worked up. He's in the council room. And he's got all these Pharisees around him, and they're like, rawr. You know, imagine, don't you? People just look ugly when they're mad. You ever notice that? You see pictures of people, and they're like really, yeah, you heretic. And here's Stephen with a face like an angel. You know, some scholars actually say that it was almost similar to an appearance that would happen with Moses when Moses' face shone with bright with light. Now, we don't know. We weren't there, and it's not recorded that way. But it's very unique that Luke did write down that he had a face like an angel, representing the innocence and the purity within his heart. And, you know, it's amazing is that following this, the next statement that comes up in Acts chapter 7, verse 1, is that the priest looks at him, the high priest looks at him and says, are these things so? And that's what begins his message in Acts chapter 7, where he explains to them exactly what he was teaching and why he was teaching it. And the reason why they rejected him, the reason why they stoned him, is because what he was saying was that you people on the council are stiff-necked and you disobey God, just like your fathers were stiff-necked and disobeyed God throughout time. Despite the many promises that were granted to them, you turned away from the promise of God and the ultimate rejection of his son, Jesus Christ. That pretty much summarizes what he was representing as he brought the whole history of what took place with Israel from the beginning, from Abraham up to the cross. He explained exactly Israel's position and why they were in the situation that they were in. It's because they were disobedient to God and they rejected the Messiah. And this very same reason why he said those things is why they killed him. So your homework, because I'm not going to read through Acts chapter 7, your homework would be to read Acts chapter 7. And I will ask you next week if you have read Acts chapter 7. Mm-hmm. Okay? Because it's really important that we, you know, we look at these things, not just here, but also realize that, you know, God wants to speak to our hearts through his word. So we can learn some things from Stephen's life. You know, one of the things that's said of him is that he was full of faith. He was a man that was full of faith. What does that mean? He believed God. He believed God for who he said he was. He allowed God to speak to his heart through his word, and he believed it as being a reality. It was more real than concrete in front of him. That's the kind of faith that we need to have. You know, people talk about faith in this mystical thing. It's that which you believe, which is the word of God. But it also becomes a part of who you are as you live by faith. You live by what you believe. But to do that, you have to believe something, right? You can't live by faith unless you've believed in something. So you have to find out what the word says. Believe that word, allow that word to be your strength, your reality, your frame of reference, how you view life. Then you can walk by that faith that you believe. It was also said that he was full of grace. Once again, being full of God's Spirit, being in tune with God, living by grace, walking by faith, realizing that all that we have is from God. There's nothing special about any of us other than the fact that God loves us. And that's something very special. God loves us very specifically. And he was known for this, the presence of the Spirit in his life. That's the kind of reputation that we want to have, to be known as someone who's filled with God's Spirit. Someone who reveals God's love, God's life, no matter what the circumstances are. He was also prepared, he was available, and he was committed. Those are true signs of servant of God, and that's what it takes to serve the King. Be prepared, be available, and be committed. Amen? Let's bow our heads. Father, we thank you, Lord, for another day that we can come into your presence and hear your word and just fellowship with each other. At this time of our service, we like to give the opportunity for anyone who has never expressed faith in Christ to do so. You know, the Bible tells us that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever would believe in him would have eternal life. That is the good news. That is the good news. But if you're here this morning and you never express faith in Christ, that's not good. So what you need to do is realize that God has loved you so much that he's made it possible for you to be a child of God by accepting the free gift of salvation that is in his Son, Jesus Christ. If you want to do that this morning, all you need to do is pray within your heart these words. Not that they're magical within themselves, but they express a heart towards God. Repeat in your heart, Father, forgive me. I am a sinner and I need a Savior. I believe that Jesus Christ died for me. I want to be a child of God. I want to be yours. If you pray that within your heart, God has already accepted you. And at the end of our service, we'll have individuals available that you can speak to if you have any questions whatsoever about this great thing that is happening to you. So, Father, I thank you, Lord, for this time. I pray, Lord, that you continue to guide your people and bless us in a mighty way. And it's in Jesus Christ's name I pray. Amen.